Whenever you go outside and look up at the sky, you'll see clouds. Some are big, white, puffy clouds, whilst others are dark and threatening. You get some clouds that are really high in the atmosphere and others that can be right in front of you. All clouds are fascinating and people have been amazed by their power and beauty for thousands of years. But you may have looked at a cloud and wondered, what type of cloud is it? What do scientists call it? What type of cloud is this? And this? And even this? How can you tell which cloud is which? How is this cloud different to this cloud? Through this video, we're going to teach you all about clouds. We're going to tell you about a man who decided to name them and how you too can spot and name clouds just like him. We're also going to show you how clouds are created and some of the weird and wonderful clouds you can find. Along the way, we're also going to tell you some awesome facts about clouds that you can impress your friends with. Clouds are one of nature's wonders, and by the end of this video, you should be able to go outside and amaze your friends and family by telling them exactly what cloud they're looking at and how it got there. When you look up at the sky, you may have asked, what cloud is that? What's its name? You may have given them names yourself because they look like something. What does this cloud look like? Can you see the animal in this one? People have found some very funny shapes in the sky, but scientists don't name the clouds this way. They have more scientific names for them. This fluffy white cloud that you may have seen in the sky is a cumulus cloud, and this low misty one is called a stratus. What do these names mean, and who gave them these strange names? The clouds were named by a man called Luke Howard, and we have one of his descendants here to tell you all about the amazing work his ancestor did.
Hello, my name is Oliver Howard, and I'm descended from Luke Howard. He was my great-great-great-grandfather. He is known to this day as the father of meteorology and the namer of the clouds. Now, you're probably wondering what we mean when we say he was the father of meteorology. Meteorology is the study of the way the weather on our planet works. So it means that he was one of the earliest serious weathermen, rather like the people who present the weather on TV today. Luke Howard was born almost 250 years ago, on the 28th of November, 1772. And although he worked as a chemist, he rarely loved to watch and record the weather, both as a schoolboy in Oxfordshire and later around London. He lived at No. 7 Bruce Grove in Tottenham in North London, and there's an English Heritage blue plaque on the front of the building to recognise how important his work was. But how did this chemist from London become such an important man in the weather world, and how did he name the clouds? It was his paper on the modifications of clouds which brought him fame and transformed the science of weather. Before he wrote the paper, no one had really come up with a way of telling which cloud was which. Luke Howard identified the three cloud types that are usually visible. They were the cumulus cloud, stratus cloud, and cirrus cloud. Although clouds are always changing and moving, he discovered you can always identify any cloud as one of these three types. Now, let's try and identify the three types of clouds and understand what these names mean. Let's start with cumulus clouds. They're easily the most recognizable ones to spot. They're known as the cotton wool tufts that form on a sunny day. They have flat bases and tops that look like the head of a cauliflower. The word cumulus means heap in Latin, and they do look like heaps of white cotton wool floating in the sky. They usually form over land on sunny days and are known as fair-weather clouds. So if you see them in the sky, you probably won't need your umbrella. But be careful, because some cumulus clouds can develop into pretty threatening thunderclouds. We're now going to show you a short video of some little cumulus clouds growing during the day into some rather scary-looking thunderclouds. As the sun rises in the morning and begins to warm the land, rising pockets of warm air form little cumulus clouds. As the day goes on, these rising pockets of warm air get stronger and stronger, reaching high up into the atmosphere, eventually becoming thunderclouds. You can see from this video how quickly clouds change and how many different types there are. You can watch out for these clouds by remembering that if it looks very tall and like a cauliflower, then you may get some rain. If you see these clouds before midday, then be prepared to get wet. An easy way to remember is in the morning mountains, in the afternoon fountains. Now let's turn to the stratus cloud. This is a low, flat and misty cloud that very much resembles fog or mist. Unlike the cumulus cloud, with its crisp cauliflower mounds, the stratus cloud is featureless and drab. It brings with it drizzle and dampness. In fact, it's a pretty depressing cloud. It's commonly found around coasts and mountains, and is the lowest forming cloud, so you'll know when it's around, as you won't be able to see very far. It may seem like a harmless cloud compared to the ones we'll look at later, but it can be quite dangerous, especially when it's very dense. This type of cloud may seem a bit boring, but stratus clouds can also be very beautiful, and they're best seen from the air to see their full beauty as they creep over the land. The final type of cloud that Luke Howard named was the cirrus cloud. Cirrus clouds are one of the highest clouds you can find. The word cirrus is the Latin word for a lock of hair, and they usually cover the sky in wispy streaks. But why do they look wispy and not puffy like other clouds? This is because high up in the atmosphere, it's so cold that clouds are made of ice crystals rather than drops of water. The ice crystals fall, and as they fall, they're whipped up by very strong wind, and so fall in streaks. Because they're so high up in the atmosphere, it looks as if they aren't moving at all, but of all the clouds, they move the fastest. Cirrus clouds may not be responsible for changes in the weather, but most importantly, they can help us to predict what it may do next. They usually signal a change in the weather and the possibility of storms, so it's always a good idea to keep a lookout for them and take an umbrella. As we've seen so far, Luke Howard's work was very important for weather forecasters today and helped them not only to identify the clouds in the sky, but also to predict what the weather might do next. I'm now going to pass you back to the narrator, tell you all about how clouds are formed and some of the strange cloud formations you can find.
So far, we've learned about all these main types of clouds that can be found, but how do they form in the first place? Clouds, no matter the shape or size, all form in the same sort of way. It's only how high they are in the sky and the conditions up there that determine what they'll look like. We're going to give you just a basic idea of how they form, as it's all a very complicated process and changes depending on the conditions. So, how do they form? Firstly, water from rivers, ponds, lakes or oceans evaporates into the air. This moist air rises up and expands as it gets higher up in the atmosphere where the pressure is lower than down on the ground. This air then cools and the water vapour changes into very tiny droplets that form into clouds. But the amazing thing about all this is that the conditions have to be just right. You need to have the right temperature, and the water also needs to hold on to something, such as particles of dust, salt or smoke, to make the cloud droplets. If these elements aren't right, then the cloud won't form. Then, when it rains, this water returns to the rivers, lakes and oceans, and the whole process starts all over again. The amazing thing is that the water makes this journey between the Earth's surface and the atmosphere 40 times a year. So far, we've looked at the three main types of clouds and how they form. Now we're going to look at some really strange clouds that you may not see every day. You may have seen some clouds making odd shapes, like this one that looks very much like a heart. These seem pretty normal compared to some of the clouds you can find. In this section of the video, we're going to look at all sorts of different clouds from all over the world, from the weird to the downright strange, and we're going to see why people thought some clouds were out of this world. First off, we're going to look at clouds that aren't made by nature, but are in fact made by us. A lot of clouds that we make have only started forming over the last century and are caused by planes, rockets and power stations. These weren't named by Luke Howard, as they wouldn't have been around when he was alive. You may have looked up and seen lots of lines zigzagging across the sky and wondered what they are. These lines are called contrails, and they're created by aeroplanes flying high in the sky near where cirrus clouds normally form. These clouds form very differently from other clouds. Have you ever breathed out on a cold day and seen your breath? Well, these clouds form in a very similar way. While most clouds are formed by moist air cooling as it rises, the hot gas from an aircraft exhaust cools and mixes with the really cold air in the atmosphere. As this air cools really, really quickly, it forms into droplets of water, which instantly turn into ice crystals behind the plane, and that's how contrails are created. The clouds we've just looked at seem pretty normal compared to some weird shapes people have seen. Some look really scary, some look just weird, and some look out of this world. First of all, let's start with the Mammatus cloud. This one was also named by Luke Howard. He didn't just name the main three types of clouds, he also named all sorts of different clouds that you can find. Now, the Mammatus cloud looks pretty terrifying, like something out of a sci-fi film. Luke Howard took this name from a Latin word that means udders, and you can see why they were named this way, as they do really look like the udders you see on cows. This cloud can be found on the underside of a number of different types of cloud, such as the cumulonimbus cloud, which is a very stormy one. But how do these strange shapes form? What's happening here is that pockets of very wet and cold air sink very quickly from the top of the storm cloud, pushing downwards and creating this strange ripple effect. These types of clouds can form in varying shapes, but as you can see, there are some pretty big threatening ones. If you ever see Mammatus clouds, then you need to be worried, because it's from these clouds that tornadoes and waterspouts often form. Some clouds look really, really scary. Some clouds look very pretty. But some clouds look like they've come from another planet. Have you ever looked up and seen something rather strange? Something that looks maybe as if it's from outer space? Well, a lot of supposed UFO spottings actually turned out to be just clouds doing some very weird things in the sky. So what clouds are these? They're known as altocumulus clouds. They form quite high in the atmosphere and tend to be found in patches of cloudlets, usually in the shape of rounded clumps or rolls. If they're shaped like UFOs, then they're called altocumulus lenticularis, which mainly form in mountainous regions where a stable layer of humid air is forced to rise over high ground, condensing its moisture into cloud. Seeing one of these clouds can be a real treat, as they're really rare. So, if you ever see a strange UFO-shaped object in the sky, do take a minute to think whether it could be a cloud creating some bizarre shapes. The final cloud we're going to look at is an extraordinary one, and it's so unique that people travel from all over the world to see it. So, what's so amazing about this cloud? Well, it only forms in one place during a few months of the year. This cloud is called the roll cloud. Variations of it can be seen all over the world, but the most famous and the most dramatic of them all can only be found in a remote part of Australia. This cloud is so amazing because it can stretch up to 600 miles long. That's the size of Britain. It only appears near Burketown in northern Queensland during the months of September and October, and people travel from all over the world in the hope of finding it. But how does this strange cloud form? And why does it only form in one place at one particular time? Scientists are still unsure as to why it only forms in this part of northern Queensland and why it only appears at a specific few months of the year. But there are a few reasons. Firstly, the location. This cloud is found in the Gulf of Carpentaria, where the Cape York Peninsula is large enough that sea breezes develop on both sides. When the breezes from both sides meet, air is forced to rise and a line of cloud forms. The different types of air create a wave formation, almost like ripples in a lake. But scientists still can't entirely predict when this strange cloud will appear. But the locals have their own ideas. They say that when fridges frost over and the cafe table corners curl upwards, then there's enough moisture in the air for the clouds to form. Spookily, when the cloud passes over, all winds stop and there's nothing but complete silence. Pretty cool for a cloud, really. The clouds we've seen so far have been both beautiful and strange, but some clouds can cause destruction wherever they go. We are, of course, talking about tornadoes. Tornadoes are probably the most dangerous clouds around, and some people risk their lives chasing them. They're violent, dangerous, rotating columns of air, which is in contact with both the surface of the earth and they form a cloud. They can have wind speeds that reach more than 300 miles an hour and stretch more than a mile across. The vast majority of tornadoes occur in the Tornado Alley in the United States. Tornadoes can be found in a variety of shapes and sizes, and some are more dangerous than others. One of the most impressive and destructive tornadoes ever seen was the Super Outbreak, which hit most of the USA and Canada on the 3rd and 4th of April 1974. This outbreak was so impressive because over 18 hours there were 148 tornadoes. At one point there were even 16 tornadoes on the ground at one time. This outbreak killed hundreds of people and caused complete destruction. Tornadoes are certainly the scariest clouds around, and it's best to keep well away from them. Another very powerful and destructive type of weather system you may have heard of are hurricanes. These huge, swirling, unstoppable forces of nature can cause billions of dollars worth of damage and destroy whole cities. So how exactly do these huge storms form? And would you see one around here? Hurricanes develop when storms pass over warm tropical oceans, picking up heat and moisture. Conditions have to be just right, and if there's a ready supply of heat and moisture, then the storm will continue to build and create a great swirl of clouds and really strong winds. These storms are most powerful out at sea, where there's plenty of heat and moisture to feed the clouds. When it hits land, it tends to lose its energy as there's no more warm air and moisture to feed it. Coastal areas can get most of the damage, where the strong winds, rain and waves can destroy houses, roads, trees and anything they hit. Hurricanes can only form where the ocean is warmer than 28 degrees or so. That's pretty much like a warm bath. So you're unlikely to see one around the UK anytime soon. To show you an example of the powerful nature of hurricanes, we're going to look at a famous one called Hurricane Katrina. It hit Louisiana on August the 29th, 2005, causing absolute destruction and becoming the most expensive hurricane in history. In this satellite image, you can see the hurricane gathering momentum as it moves over the warm ocean currents. When it reaches land, you can see it loses its power and slowly breaks down, but not after causing massive destruction to New Orleans and the people who lived there. You may have noticed a hole in the middle of the hurricane as it grew to its most powerful. This is known as the eye of the storm, and it's an area of sinking air at the centre of the hurricane. Surrounding this is a ring of towering thunderstorms where the most severe weather occurs. But the very centre is a calm area that's free of clouds, and some can be as big as 230 miles in diameter. Next time you hear about hurricanes on the news, you'll be able to understand how deadly and powerful they really are. In this video, we've seen the impressive nature of clouds, and you can see why people have tried to copy their beautiful shapes and colours. Artists such as John Constable have tried to capture the strange shapes that clouds make, and no doubt you've even had a go yourself. Even poets such as William Wordsworth have tried to express in words the qualities of clouds with lines such as, "I wandered lonely as a cloud that floats on high o'er vales and hills." And there are also films that have centred around the destructive nature of clouds. The film Twister shows the unpredictable and devastating power of tornadoes. And who can forget that scene from The Day After Tomorrow, when a series of tornadoes completely destroys Los Angeles? In this video, we've shown you some amazing clouds. We've told you all about how they form and what they're called. We've told you about Luke Howard, who named the clouds, and we've shown you just how important his work was. Clouds and their power and beauty can be admired in many ways. And now you can go outside and start looking at clouds and understand where they came from, what they are, and what they might become.